Good morning. We welcome you to the Rocky Ridge Church. Everyone who is watching and worshiping with us by way of Facebook and YouTube, we welcome you as to our service as well. This is the first Sunday in September. This year has been going by so fast, and we're just a few weeks away from the beginning of fall. And it's beginning to feel like it. The last couple of mornings, we're getting a little bit of a taste of what is coming down the road. I hope you're doing well. Hope you're staying well. You and your family alike, we continue to be mindful of the challenges that we're facing during this COVID pandemic as it continues and now in different forms, if you will. In different ways, we realize that the challenges we faced last year have now, again, are the challenges we're facing this year as well. Not sure what we should expect come next year, other than the one thing that remains the same, in light of this remaining the same, is that God is faithful and God is with us. So we find no reason to stop coming together and rejoicing in Him. Praising His name. And I'm grateful for those of you who have chosen to do so one way and the other. We again welcome you to this worship service. I appreciate those of you who are using this slip of paper that we have placed in the bulletin the last few Sundays. Some of you on the side that says connections have given us some information about yourself that has changed with regard to your address, your email and so forth, and that's good. We appreciate that, because there are times we definitely want to connect, and having the right information is essential for that. So we appreciate you doing so, and if you haven't, we hope you'll take the time to fill that in. But this is not just for that kind of information. There may be something going on right now that you need to share with us, something in your life that you need some help, or you need our awareness of what is going on with you. Please share that information if you feel comfortable in doing so. Any way we might be able to help or be an encouragement to you certainly is something that we desire to do in our hearts. The other side of the slip of paper, again, a reminder, is for prayer concerns, and that is ongoing. While our address may stay the same for a while, or our other basic information about ourselves, our needs definitely are coming and going in various ways. And the needs of those around us, and being able to share those with others, and knowing that you have prayer partners in light of these things is very, very helpful. And so be sure to share that information if you feel it will be helpful to you or to someone else that you're praying for, as much as you feel you're comfortable in sharing. Again, this is to be dropped in the collection plate. Last thing we do before we leave this the sanctuary and we go out into the world is to leave our offerings, and we can leave these at the same time in the collection plate that's out here in the narthex there on the table. So please keep that in mind. Those are the announcements that I wanted to share with you this morning, other than to remind you again that we are meeting on Wednesdays for Bible study. We are putting this on our internet, and we put it on our Facebook. So if you don't have the opportunity to come for the Bible study, you still have an opportunity to participate in the Bible study at a later time. We're studying the 12 apostles. We continue. I believe this coming Wednesday we're going to be talking about James the Younger, or James the Less. That'll be this coming Wednesday. It'll be at 10 a.m. and we meet in the what is it, the Builder's Sunday School classroom? Or no, that's not it. Frontier, thank you. Now the Frontiers Sunday School classroom. We meet in there, and we certainly hope you can come and take part. Those are the announcements for you this morning. Unless Jackie, you have anything you might want to share about the children? Anything? Okay. If not, then let us prepare our hearts for worship today. Let us pray. Father, as we come before you this morning, we have come in anticipation of this opportunity to be here with you today, and also to join in this manner of worship with brothers and sisters in Christ. We're grateful for those, again, who have gathered with us in this place and who are gathering with us online, even as I speak. And we look to you, Father, as we come with hearts ready to praise you and to worship you. We pray that you will receive our act of worship as our offering of love for you today, and you will pour out your Spirit upon our time of gathering with you. Pour out your Spirit upon us, Lord, and draw us into the oneness of your Spirit with you and with one another. Let our hearts, Father, rejoice in you, and that as you lift us up and you bless us, everything you share with us today, Father, in this time of meeting, we pray that you will also lead us from here to take with us out into the world in which we go again, that we might share the good news of what it is like having been with you, and to share the message of hope that you, again, declare to us through your Son, Jesus Christ. I pray that your Spirit be upon those who lead us in music, those who also, Father, are in prayer on behalf of this service, upon your servant who will declare your word shortly as well. And I pray, Father, that everything that results from this will give you the honor and will give you the glory, all of it, for it is yours and yours alone. And I ask this through Jesus' name. Amen. Oh, come and let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker.
Please stand and join me this morning as we sing. this then is how you ought to regard us, as servants of Christ and as those entrusted with the mysteries God has revealed. Now, it is required that those who have been given a trust must prove faithful. I care very little if I am judged by you or any human court. Indeed, I do not even judge myself. My conscience is clear, but that does not make me innocent. It is the Lord who judges me. Therefore, judge nothing before the appointed time. Wait until the Lord comes. He will bring to light what is hidden in darkness and expose the motives of the heart. At that time, each will receive their praise from God.
Be seated. Certainly that should be our prayer, shouldn't it? Every one of God's children, we want our hearts changed in any way and every day until in any way and every day we are like Him, and all that people see Jesus living in us and living through our lives as well. At this time, I would like you to join me as we declare our faith together with the Apostles' Creed. The words will be up on the screen if you want to follow along with me. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. In just a few moments, I'm going to be sharing from God's Word with you. And if you want to go ahead and find your place, we're going to be reading from the Old Testament, from the book of Exodus. And I'm going to be reading out of the 8th chapter, beginning with verse 1. It Before we go to the Word of God and we hear the message that the Lord has for us today, I want to take a few moments again to remind you of the opportunity that we have together today to be in unison as we pray. Praying for the needs of our church family, praying for the needs of those that God has allowed this church family to touch. And there are many, many more lives to be considered in light of that. Praying in need of our church all throughout the world. And praying for their well-being, praying that God will continue to bless them and use them as a blessing. And this world needs the blessing of God. And especially as he works through his people. Let's pray that we all are able to be where we need to be and that we are the lights that we are meant to be. Truly, it's Jesus who's the light, who is living in us, but also living through us as well, allowing us to be a light in that manner for the world in which we live. Let us be in prayer for the leadership of this congregation. I know I covet your prayers, and I ask your prayers for those who hold other positions of leadership, beginning with your session, with your elders and others alike who lead in different capacities. Pray for one another. Pray for the strength that we need to remain faithful before our Lord, the strength that we need to be able to meet the challenges that we all have to face in this world, the challenges that we face within the flesh itself. And of course, not forgetting the enemy, the devil himself, and the evil that he is continuing to carry on throughout the world. It's not just that we withstand his temptation, but that we remember the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's the gates of hell that will not prevail against the people of God. It's not so much worrying of him crashing into the church, though we must beware of this, but it's us crashing into his world and taking captive that which belongs to the Lord, and doing so in his name for his glory. So let's pray that God gives us the wisdom, gives us the strength, as well as the opportunities to be able to do so. Let us pray for one another as we go to our Lord. We pray. Father, again, to you we come. Not just with our heads bowed, but with our hearts also before you. We come giving you praise and giving you thanksgiving, realizing while we have this privilege to come, it's also an answer to your call for us to come before you in this manner. And as we offer up these prayers to you today, we do so recognizing again that it's not the will of your people that is at the center of this that we pray for, but it's your will, Father, that should be at the center of your people. And we pray that you will help our hearts to be so centered. As we hold up before you, it's seeking that which will in the end give you glory. And we know that in that, it will be for the good of those who need your goodness. Help us to be the church that we are meant to be, a light and in the world in which we live, salt, Father, making a difference in the lives of those that we are allowed to associate with, in the lives of one another, but also in the lives of others in our world who need your touch as well. Thank you for being there and for the difference you're making throughout this world, through this particular church called Cumberland Presbyterians, through your whole church. We're grateful to be a part of that which serves you and gives you and all the glory and is able to accomplish good for others on your behalf. Help us, Father, to be strong, to resist what we need to resist, but also to respond willfully and wholeheartedly to you when we are given the opportunity to answer your call upon our lives. Prepare our hearts now for the message that is to be delivered. And I ask, Lord, that you help me again to focus my mind, which, Lord, you know so often it just wants to go every which way. Help me, Father, to be focused on you and upon your word. There's nothing that I can say that needs to be said apart from what is in your heart to be said. So I pray that I won't be one who gets in the way, but I want to be an instrument you use to share that which is your word for your people. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, if you have your Bible in hand, you can turn with me now to Exodus chapter 8. And I'm going to go ahead and tell you, I gave to Susan to put up on the screen verses 1 through 10. And I'm going to read those verses, but I'm not going to stop. I'm going to go read on down through verse 15. You won't find the verses 11 through 15 I'm on the screen, I don't imagine, but verses 1 through 10 probably will show up there for you to follow along. 7 days passed after the Lord struck the Nile. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Go to Pharaoh and say to him, 'This is what the Lord says. Let my people go so that they may worship me. If you refuse to let them go, then I will plague your whole country with frogs.' Now they're going to come up to your palace and into your bedroom and unto your bed, into the houses of your officials and on your people and into your ovens and your kneading troughs. The frogs will go up on you and your people and all your officials." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Tell Aaron to stretch out your hand and your staff over the streams and the canals and the ponds and make frogs come up under the land of Egypt." So Aaron stretched out his hand over the waters of Egypt, and the frogs came up and they covered the land. But the magicians did the same things by their secret arts. They also made frogs come up on the land of Egypt. Pharaoh then summoned Moses and Aaron, and he said, "Pray to the Lord and take the frogs away from me and my people, and I will let your people go and offer their sacrifices to the Lord." Moses said to Pharaoh, "I leave to you the honor of setting the time for me to pray for you and your officials and your people, that you and your houses may be rid of the frogs, except for those that remain in the Nile." "Tomorrow," Pharaoh said. Moses replied, "It will be as you say, so that you may know there is no one who is like the Lord our God. The frogs will leave you in your houses and your officials and your people. They will remain only in the Nile." Now after Moses and Aaron had left Pharaoh, Moses cried out to the Lord about the frogs that he had brought on Pharaoh. And the Lord did what Moses asked. The frogs died in the houses and in the courtyards and in the fields. And they were piled up in heaps, and the land reeked with them. But when Pharaoh saw that there was relief, he hardened his heart and would not listen to Moses and Aaron, just as the Lord had said. That is the reading of God's word for the people of God. How did we come to this place? Well, without going into a great deal of explanation, there was a time when there was a famine, or there was a time rather back in the old country, in Israel, if you will, when Joseph was sold into slavery, and as a result he was taken to Egypt. Again, making this long story short, ultimately he rose to a high esteem in Egypt. In fact, he held a position that was only second to that of Pharaoh. And during the and because there was a famine back in the land of Israel, he invited his people to come and to live with him there in Egypt so that they might be well fed and cared for. And for some time, they did good. You know, they had it really made, you might say, while Joseph was in his position. And the Pharaoh was also very kind toward them all. But after Joseph's passing and the passing of this Pharaoh, as time went on, things began to change. The numbers of the Israelites grew, for one thing, and they became a threat in the eyes of this particular Pharaoh. So he decided to make them slaves and make them to work on his behalf. And the burden of these pharaohs, including the one that we just read about here, was so heavy for so long upon the people of God that they cried out over and over unto the Lord. And ultimately, we know that he called Moses to go back into Egypt and there to lead his people to freedom. But he said, you're going to have a little bit of a difficulty with this. Not really, but you're going to have opposed, because this Pharaoh is not going to welcome what the news that I bid you to bring to him. He's not going to be in favor of letting my people go. And so it was, this Pharaoh indeed did not want to cooperate with the word of God. And as a result, we know that there's going to be a series of plagues. And it's going to get really nasty before it's all over with. God said Pharaoh had the kind of heart that would not work with him. But he was going to come anyway. And Pharaoh was going to resist him. And as a result, it wasn't going to hurt God, but it was going to hurt Pharaoh. His heart would grow harder and harder because of his resistance to the Lord. That in itself should be a lesson for me and for you, that a heart that's in rebellion to God, a heart that resists the Lord, is going to become harder. And the things that we should take hold of are going to become more difficult for us, because the things we should let go of are going to be harder to let go of. This is what was happening in the case of Pharaoh. And God, the second plague that came amongst them was the plague of the frogs. Of course, the frog was it was made in the form of a goddess in Egypt, the goddess of fertility, of life, and what have you. But this was a little more to life than he really wanted at this point, because frogs were everywhere. Even as God said they would be, they were all over the place. They were in his palace. They were in his bedroom. They were in his sheets of his bed. He couldn't even get in bed and go to sleep because of all the frogs. They were in the kitchen. They were in the oven. You couldn't walk down the road without stepping on frogs. They were all over the place, everywhere, getting in the way. These frogs were becoming a real problem for Pharaoh, so much so that he finally called Moses and Aaron to come back before him, and he made sort of a deal, if you will, and said if they would get rid of the frogs, he would let the people go off and sacrifice to the Lord. And Moses said, okay, when do you want us to get rid of the frogs? And there's his answer: tomorrow. And that's the thing that always really grabs you. I mean, here's a guy who's been, you know, dealing with these frogs. You know, they've worried him, they've wearied him, and yet he's ready to wait a little bit longer, even one more night. But before we get too hard on Pharaoh about his response, you know, we might need to remember, too, that we have probably done just as much in times with God. I have found that man is very prone to do something tomorrow rather than to do it today. If he can put it off, he generally chooses to put it off. We're famous for what we're going to do, in fact, tomorrow. I mean, we really mean to get right with God. We really mean to get our lives, the way they should be before the Lord. But the idea is we're going to do this, but not today. It's going to be tomorrow. I want you to write down Hebrews chapter 3 and verses 7 through 8. The Bible says, therefore, as the Holy Spirit says, that is, as the Holy Spirit speaks, today when you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion on the day of the testing in the wilderness. Don't harden yourself when you hear the voice of God, when the Holy Spirit beckons. Don't resist, but answer the call. Respond to him in the way that you should. Don't put him off. I cannot tell you the many times over the years of my ministry when I have talked to different people, and this is not something that's happened just a mere few times, but it's happened many times. When I'm talking to somebody who knows their life is not right with the Lord, and will even confess that much, and they know they need to change, they know they need to get right, they will tell me something along these lines: "Preacher, I understand that I'm not right with God. I know that I should change, and I intend to change, but not now. But not today. I will change perhaps tomorrow." And I've not only people who do not know the Lord, but even those who profess Him to be the Lord of their lives. When they find that their lives are not right with Him, when they realize God is dealing with them, they too, many times, will have said to me pretty much the same things. I know I'm not right with my God. I know I'm not where I should be with Him, and I'm going to do something about it, but I'm not ready to do something about it now. I'm thinking of a passage of Scripture that's found in the New Testament. It's in the book of Luke, and it's in the 9th chapter. Jesus has been speaking to some people, and He bids them an invitation to come and follow after Him. And among those are three people in particular that the Scriptures at this time mention. And every one of them say, yes, they will follow after Him. But I think one of them sums up all three of their minds when he says these particular words. He says, "Lord, I will follow You, but first. The word "Lord" indicates that we are acknowledging that He is in charge, that He is in control, that He is the one who deserves to be at the center of our lives. He is the one who should be calling the shots for my life. He is God, and I'm not. But when we say things like, "I will follow You," and we use the word "Lord," and then we go on to say, "But first," there's an indication there, is there not, that He is not really set as far as our minds and hearts are concerned at the center of our lives. He's still not really in control of what's going on with us. You know, we might think in our minds, "He is Lord." We might even, with our lips, say it aloud, "He is Lord." But what are we saying by our actions? What are we saying by the decisions that we are making? Is He truly Lord? What's keeping me, if there is something keeping me? What is preventing me from giving my all to Him and making a total surrender, a complete commitment of my life to God? And the answer, obviously, in whatever form it may be, is because of sin. Self-seeking, self-satisfying, self-absorbing, self-serving sin. That's what always gets in the way, isn't it? In one form or the other, it's getting in the way. It's preventing me from saying yes to my Lord. It gives me, my friends, the opportunity to respond to God when He has said He's ready to take the frogs out of my life, to take all the things out of my life that shouldn't be there, that are bringing difficulty to my life and damage to my life. It leads me, when I am living my life in this sense of that I'm still somehow in control, it leads me to say tomorrow rather than today. If it's painful today and there's an opportunity to deal with it today, ought it not be dealt with today? I mean, why one more night with the frogs who confine us and who confound us and who control us and who continue to conquer us? Why one more night with anything that is so destructive to your life? Why one more night living a life that is defined in Romans 7 as a life that says, "For what I want to do, I do not do, and what I hate to do, I do." A life that is a contradiction to everything it professes, to everything it wants and it hopes for. But tomorrow the frogs may not be gone. They may not be gone when we somehow or another presume that we are in control when we're really not. I'm going to give you some reasons today, and I will try to sum this up somewhat shortly, why we need to say, you know, we don't need to spend one more night with the frogs. We need to say, yeah, tonight, today is the day. Let them go. It's because, again, the frogs may not leave tomorrow. That's the first thing, if you haven't already written it down. I think in Pharaoh's mind, by waiting yet another night, somehow or another, I have this feeling in his mind, he was thinking that he was still somehow in control. See, if I don't answer God right now, and I say tomorrow, it's somehow, he's always been used to being in control. I'm still kind of in control of my situation. Even though it's not what I want it to be, somehow, if I hold on a little bit longer, things are going to change, even if I don't change. Even if I don't change anything about myself or what I'm doing right now with my life, somehow, maybe, if I can hold off one more night, things are going to get better. They're going to change. I was a little boy years ago. I was in bed asleep that night, and I woke up. I woke up, and I was feeling around, and there was something in my mouth. And I felt it with my tongue, and I realized what it was. A filling had dropped out of one of my teeth. And I realized what that meant. I was going to be going to the dentist, and I did not like, pardon me, David, I didn't like going to the dentist. I was afraid of the dentist. You see, back then, we were quite poor. And you know, the dentists that I got to go to were the ones in training. Yeah, the ones with no experience. They were getting their experience on me. And I didn't like the thought that I'm going to the dentist. So I know I was still pretty much asleep in my, not altogether awake. And I said to myself, you know what? If I go back to sleep, when I wake up in the morning, that filling is going to be right back in my tooth. And everything's going to be all right. That's what I presumed. But you know what happened? When I woke up in the morning, I felt, and there was a big hole in my tooth where that filling had been. I don't know if I swallowed the filling or what. I don't remember what happened to it, now that I think about it. But it wasn't where it was supposed to be. Somehow we feel like if we can, maybe in our dreams or whatever, we can get control of what's going on in our lives and ignore what's the consequences and what we need to do, it somehow can work all out for us, and it doesn't. It doesn't. In the book of Acts, in the 24th chapter, I'm thinking about the governor Felix, who was brought before Paul, and Paul was the one who was on trial, but in this instance, Felix was on trial. And when Paul was speaking to Felix, Felix began to fear. The scriptures say that. He became afraid. He was under conviction. And at that moment, listen to what he said to Paul. He said, "That's enough for now. You may leave, and when I find it convenient, I will send for you." When I find it convenient. In other words, he's in control. God has brought conviction upon his life, and yet he's ready to wait. He doesn't want to deal with it because it's not, in his estimate, convenient to be dealt with. Now, the Bible goes on to tell us in that same chapter that 2 years pass, and he never finds it convenient to call Paul back to audience and to talk to him about the matter. Whether he ever did or not, we are not told. Listen to me, folks. The frogs, they may not be gone tomorrow. You know, right now, God's dealing with my heart and your heart about things, and this is when we need to deal with them. You know, not at our convenience, but at his command and at his beckoning, we should be responding. But let me give you a second thing that we need to keep in mind, and why we need to deal with this issue, is because something worse than the frogs may come in their place. In Pharaoh's case and in Egypt's case, that's exactly what happens, isn't it? I said this was the second plague, and there were going to be 10 of them before it was all said and done. And each one of them following this one, things get worse and worse. Not better, but worse. Pharaoh thought, if I just wait, you know, maybe if I can outwait God. Maybe I can outwait my problems and my circumstances, my sins and my shortcomings. Maybe I can outwait these things. He thought he could tolerate this yet another night because somehow, some way, he felt it was going to get better when only it was going to get worse. Listen to what it says in the book of Jeremiah. And this is in the second chapter, verse 19. And the prophet says, your wickedness will punish you. Your backsliding will rebuke you. These people were resisting God. There was still time to repent, but they weren't going to repent at this point. And they were resisting the Lord. And he said, your wickedness is going to punish you and your backsliding is going to rebuke you. Consider then and realize how evil and bitter it is for you to forsake the Lord your God and to have no awe of him. And yet, they did resist. And it did get worse. Much worse. When we put off what we know we should do, there's a word for that. It's called procrastination. It's the, I like what the little sign said one time. And how it said, why wait? Procrastinate today. And I pray, procrastination. And I'm putting it off and putting it off. Someone said, and I wrote the words down. I'm sorry I can't give the credit to whoever it was. But he said, delay is the most deadly form of denial. Delay is a deadly form of denial. It's assuming that you can delay. Assuming that, again, you are in charge. I can't help but think of what is said by James in his letter. It's in the fourth chapter of the book of James. And this is his response to people who were taking God and taking life, if you will, for granted apart from God. Now listen to you who say that today or tomorrow I will go to this or that city and I'll spend a year there and I'll carry on business and I'll make money. Why, you don't even know what will happen tomorrow? What is your life? You are a mist which appears but for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast and you brag, and all such boasting is evil. Anyone then who knows the good that he ought to do and he doesn't do it sins. Procrastination is not just a bad idea. It's sinful. It's sinful. And it leaves us with the assumption that, again, we're in control, that we can go ahead and live our life, and whatever it is that God's dealing us with, eventually we'll get to that too. And we will deal with that at our convenience, in our time, rather than in his. There's a third thing, and this is the last thing I want to share with you today, about why we shouldn't spend one more night with the frogs. And that is, tomorrow may not even come. Tomorrow may not even come, at least for some. And that's pretty much what James was saying too, wasn't it? Tomorrow may not come. And life is so short, who knows when the last day is? And sometimes it comes suddenly, doesn't it? Without warning, certainly without our expecting it. It just arrives. I was in a revival years ago, young minister preaching at this church, and I had preached on the first night, and we gave the invitation, and there were a few people who responded to the invitation. But I kind of noticed that the pastor was looking over in an area of the church from time to time. And after the service was over, I asked him, what was going on. He said there was a man who was in attendance that night that he knew God was dealing with his heart. He himself had been talking to him, and he just felt like that night when the invitation was given, he was going to come to the altar and respond to the call. But he didn't. But he said, I just know in my heart that he's coming. And I tell you what, we're going to look for him to come down tomorrow night. Well, when the next evening came along and we preached again, I looked around and I couldn't find the man in the service. And at the end of the service, there was another guy who came in kind of late, stood at the back of the church, and he came up during the invitation and whispered something in the preacher's ear. What happened was the man that we were looking for, he had gone out into his pasture and ought to take care of his cattle. And while he was there caring for his cattle, evidently he had a heart attack and he died. He died. I don't know where his heart was with the Lord. I don't know that he did make his peace with God. But I know he wasn't there for the service and for the invitation that was given the second time. He didn't show up because he couldn't show up at that time. Tomorrow may not come. Some of us have had close calls in our life and we thought there would be no tomorrow. We thought that was it. I know I have. And maybe you have as well. I remember as a little boy, I fell in Granny's branch. Granny's branch was a creek, and it came out of the Kentucky Lake up in Tennessee. And I fell in there, and I was drowning. And I remember I was very young. I was not a Christian, had never professed the Lord in any way. And I, in my panic, I did what probably a lot of people drowning would do. I grabbed something to help me. Only what I grabbed was at the bottom of the creek. And I held onto it with everything I had. And I was drowning myself. And for whatever reason, I can remember it just as sure as I'm standing before you. It's still as vivid in my mind that I suddenly thought of God. And I said, God, ready or not, here I come. And I wasn't ready. I was not. My grandfather, Pounds, my dad's dad, heard the splashing. He thought at first it was a big fish. You see, Granny's branch wasn't that deep. And while I was holding onto this branch at the bottom, my feet were sticking up out of the water. And he saw that. And so he came over and grabbed hold of my foot. And he said it was everything he could do to not let me pull him in with him. But I wasn't ready. And I'm grateful to God that he didn't call me out of this world at that moment. And it was a few years later that I did receive Jesus Christ as my Savior. Not everyone gets an opportunity for a second chance, I guess. I've had many chances, not just one. All of us do by the grace of God, but today is the day if God is dealing with our hearts. Not tomorrow, but today. See, there's four things you can't do with the frogs. And I'm going to close with this. You cannot control them. Pharaoh found that out quickly. They were everywhere, and he couldn't make it any better than that. He couldn't control them. He couldn't confine them. That's the second thing. You know, we think sometimes when we sin, and all, we can confine that sin to whatever area of our life in which it immediately, you know, comes in contact with. That somehow we can keep it right there. But sin has a way of spreading, doesn't it? You cannot confine it. You cannot control it. You can't compromise with sin. That's the third thing. Sin doesn't come into your life. It may start with a compromise, but when it takes over, it's in charge. It's not looking to make life any better for you. Sin is simply going to do what sin does, and it's not good in the outcome. Fourthly, you cannot conquer sin. No matter how sincere you may be, no matter how determined you are in the moment, you may think you're getting the upper hand, but in the end, you're always the one who ends up being the conquered. Sin wins over you every time. There is only one who has conquered it, and that is Jesus. And only through him do we find the victory that we need for our lives. So what I'm saying is, we need to give our frogs, whatever they be, to Jesus, not tomorrow, but today. Not tomorrow, but today. Moses told Pharaoh, I leave it up to you. You know, you get to make the choice. And it's really up to you and me as God speaks to our hearts in light of where we are and what we need from him. Let us choose today. Let us choose him today. Amen. Let us pray. Father, I thank you for this word. I thank you for the many ways in which it has spoken to my life and how it is again being shared with those who are listening to today. And I pray that we'll all respond as we need to respond, every one of us, because we all have a tendency to presume. We have a tendency and all to try to put off what we need to deal with right now. But we're not in charge. Help us to know that we need to take advantage of that which is offered us in the moment, because it comes by grace and by love. To you we give the glory, in Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand, and we're going to sing our hymn of invitation. If any feels the need to respond, I invite you to come. Amazing grace. Let us express our love to our Lord yet again in this act of worship, the giving of our tithes and our offerings. Each of you should give as you have made up your mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. We will close with a prayer of dedication and a prayer of benediction as well. Father, we close this service again with yet another act of worship and love for you by the giving of our offerings and tithes. We pray again that you will bless the ones whose hearts are open to give, bless the gift that is given, and those then that are going to be in charge of using that which has been given for your glory and for your good and for the good of the world, that your kingdom might grow as a result. We thank you, our Lord, that we have had this time together. As we leave here today again, help us to remember the passage that we have shared this morning. Remember again that today is the day for salvation. Today is the day for your people to say yes and not to respond to you in whatever manner in which you speak to their hearts. If tomorrow were the day, you would wait till tomorrow, but today is the day. Dismiss us now in your spirit. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.